But not too many. There were, I know that, I think in Europe it was happening more. Tangerine Dream was doing some, I can't think of many. That's a very, very good question, and I should know the answer.
Cat Stevens did one.
The case did Percy.
Well, that's true. Percy was 69, I think, or 70.
Yeah.
So there was some, but the thing is, in some ways, those, Percy is almost like a concept album, like Arthur, in some ways. So, the Circle, remember the song Red Rubber Ball?
Sure.
I just found this out because it was just reissued. They did the soundtrack to an X-rated movie called The Minx. It was just reissued on, wait for it, pink vinyl. And it's okay. It's kind of dorky. You couldn't think of a much squarer band than The Circle. Paul Simon writes your hit. That's pretty square.
Alan Price.
A lucky man. That's a little later, though. Yeah, but yes, good point. It says here, okay, fast forward, or slow forward, to January 1972. Pink Floyd rent, they knew, okay, it's time for some new material. They had been doing The Embryo, Cymbeline, Green is the Color, Fat Old Son, and there's one other I always think of. There's five songs that they extended. The album versions are 2.5, 3 minutes long, kind of underdeveloped pieces. But live, those songs became these beautiful masterworks. And I actually brought along what was playing when you walked in was, I've got some bootleg LPs, and it's just live versions of some of those songs. I love it all, but that's my favorite period. By 72, they realized they needed new material. So they rented some warehouse space from the Rolling Stones in London. And in January 72, they began routining and writing new material for a stage, a new work, which they initially were calling Eclipse, a piece for Assorted Lunatics. And the idea, it was going to be not a concept album in terms of this sort of linear narrative, but a suite of songs that were really designed to be listened to start to finish, in the same way that The Man and the Journey, which was never released as an album, was. It was a musical, not to sound pretentious, but a musical experience that was designed to last 45 minutes or 36 minutes or whatever. By the end of January, they were ready, or nearly ready, to premiere this work. And the first show they did was in Brighton, England. The new material, which would eventually be what would come out 14 months later as The Dark Side of the Moon, was still in development. A lot of the songs hadn't been written. What was playing on the turntable earlier was one of the performances prior to the release of Dark Side of the Moon. Some of the songs hadn't been written yet. There was a piece called The Religion Song, which held, it was like a placeholder, if you will. And that was playing on the turntable. What I'm going to play you now is the very first, this is from a bootleg, and this was not released on the box set, and you'll see why. The very first time, I cut a little piece out of it to save a little bit of time, and it's kind of a bad edit, but, forgive me. This is the first performance of Money in Brighton in January 1972. They used a lot of backing tapes. Oh, hold on, let me pause again for a second. So, to back up, sorry, I should have gotten this right. They were using a lot of lights, a lot of things like this, but it drew a lot of power. So much power, in fact, that when it came time for some of the backing tapes to run, they ran slow. That could cause problems if you're trying to play along with it. This is a long time before MIDI was even thought of. So here's what happened the first time they tried to play Money. Something has gone bad. That buzz, that's what the audience is hearing.
This was intentional.
Oh, you heard boom?
Yeah.
Something, pop. That's the end of the religion song there. You know, the audience is probably looking at us like, okay. Okay. Turn a little slow. So what does Waters do? Okay. Plays along with it. Too slow. Because it's in Saturn. I mean, that's how you gotta do it. The rest of the bands are, really? You want us to join in? People hasn't even started to play. He's like, really? Okay. And the audience is like, power to the tape playback machine made it run at, instead of just not working, it ran. Exactly. Like batteries, yeah. And so it was not on the tape, but what was recorded, written down by journalists who were there with pens and sharp knives in hand. They said that Roger Waters says, well, that was unfortunate. We're going to take a break and we're going to come back and play some of our old stuff. And so that's what they did. So they didn't even play the second half of the album. They just... The next night, they went on to Southampton, went really well. The cool thing is, they performed The Dark Side of the Moon, which eventually became known as, something like 50-odd times in that period between January 72 and March 73. I have 47 bootlegs. I've got, and what's cool is that you can actually hear the development from night to night. It's like, well, there's a placeholder, no, that didn't work, throw that out, and the next night they come up with something better. They're still writing lyrics, weeks into that. And it's fascinating, and it was a really, really useful, that hobby that was never going to have any point, turned out to be very, very useful when I was writing the book to be able to go through and listen to how this piece developed over time. We're nearly done. Is there any, a few more? Yeah.
So, in the Valley of Steer by Clouds, did they just like do that on the side while they were doing this?
You, sir, have, that's exactly what I'm getting ready to tell you.
Oh, okay.
Perfect. So, they started doing, January 72, they started rehearsing and writing Dark Side of the Moon. They began performing in it. Summer of 72, Barbe Schrader calls him up again and says, I got another film for you. I don't know if that's how he said it, but basically, they were offered another film soundtrack project. So halfway through the recording of The Dark Side of the Moon, they head across the channel, to a studio in Paris, and in 2 weeks, write and record an entire other album of music. Completely unconnected, disconnected, non-connected to Dark Side of the Moon, but musically very much a piece of it. The songs are different, But the studio is a lot more primitive than Abbey Road. But so they don't have access to all the same gear. But the aesthetic, the songwriting aesthetic, the arrangement mindset was quite similar. And so when they wrote this set of songs for La Vallée, or however you say it in French, Obscure by Clouds is what it was called, the songs sound similar. They sound like the same kind of music. In fact, for people who aren't at all familiar with pre-Dark Side of the Moon music, if somebody says, where should I start? I recommend that they start with the album Obscured by Clouds, because it won't sound alien to you in a way that Saucer Full of Secrets might. So I'm just going to play you just a little piece of my favorite track off of Obscured by Clouds, which was recorded again. Halfway through. So they worked on Dark Side of the Moon, then they went to France, recorded Obscured by Clouds, then they came back, kept recording Dark Side of the Moon, finished it, then Obscured by Clouds came out, then Dark Side of the Moon came out. That's the chronology.
Is that the name of the movie too?
The film is called The Valley, or La Valley, however you say valley in French. With two E's and a little bit of the movie.
Valley.
Yeah, very good. That.
Not to be pretentious.
Drier sound to it than Dark Side of the Moon is because of the studio, but the feel is similar. They actually performed this song live briefly, and it would go 10 minutes, 11 minutes long live. Here it's about 5. I'm only playing it, but it's not even a minute of it, and that's the end of that. So basically, the thesis of my book, if there were a thesis. Oh, there's more on it. I'll just go that way. That's my signal. It's done. But I'm done talking. Every line goes on. But they're a band that never threw away a good idea. They're a band that learned from their mistakes. And that with the benefit of hindsight, everything that they did from January 1968 to March 73 was an inexorable step toward making the Dark Side of the Moon. Even though they didn't know it at the time, they didn't know where they were going, that's where they were going. That linear mindset that they had, with the benefit of hindsight, it was a straight path. Here's where I ask if you have any. I love not all of it. I think a lot of critics, and I would probably tend to agree with them, would say that strictly on the merits, out of context, their following out, Wish You Were Here, is actually even a little bit better than Dark Side. We don't have to pick, it's like kids. Which kid do you like better? Who the hell's gonna answer that? And there is no answer. Wish You Were Here wouldn't have been possible without Dark Side of the Moon. The same with Dark Side of the Moon wouldn't have been possible without more Saucer Full of Secrets, Adam Hart Mother, so on and so forth. I really like Animals, which is sort of Pink Floyd's answer to punk. It wasn't seen that way at the time, but there's a really jagged, nasty edge to that. And I think that musically is some of David Gilmour's best guitar playing. Unfortunately, by that point, the dynamic of the band had shifted. From 68 to 73, they were, as much as you can imagine, in my opinion, a band of as close to as possible equals, collaborative. It wasn't, I'm the guy and you guys are my posse. They work together. All the really interesting sonic textures that are going on, we have Nick Mason to thank for that. He was really the sonic architect of the game. Richard Wright's keyboard work is so integral, especially on Wish You Were Here, and a lot of their albums. But after Dark Side, Waters was the sole lyricist from then onward, and he began to think of it as his band, and with each successive album, it became more and more a Roger Waters vehicle. And that's not to denigrate the contributions of the other members, but they began to get interested in their own things. Nick Mason, as you may know, got very into automobile racing. He's got 30 cars or something now to this day. He still does Formula One racing and things like that. I think Richard Wright discovered cocaine. That took his attention away from things for a little while. Gilmore made a really good solo album called David Gilmore. The band again was Splinter. Animals for me is their last creative gasp. I'm one of those people who doesn't much. I respect and appreciate them all, but do I ever listen to it? The whole damn album was built around da 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 da. Two-thirds of that album was built around that three note motif.
That
was 77. The Wall came out in 79. For me, The Wall gets a little boring and theatrical. There's still some amazing music out there, but as a listening experience, by that point, Richard Wright was paid. He had been fired from the band, and then he was hired back as an employee. And as a result, the Wall tour, they only did three or four cities. They did L.A., they did New York City, they did London, it may have been one of them. But it was this massive production, not the Roger Waters Wall of later years, but The Wall. They only did those three or four cities where the roadies built the wall in front of them while they were performing. They lost so much money on that tour because it was so expensive. Richard Wright is the only one who made any money because he was on a salary. Then they made the Final Cut, which I know a lot of people love that album. I'm not one of those people. There's some good tunes on it, but so Wright is not in the band. There's no Gilmore compositions on it. He doesn't want to be there. And then the band breaks up. And then they get back together without Waters, and there's that whole litigation thing, which I don't cover in the book. I cover up to 73. There's a few chapters at the end where I kind of breeze through the rest of it. I was lucky enough to see them on the 87 tour and the 94 tour, and I saw Waters on the 99 tour. And his new album, last year, who's heard Roger Waters? Is this what we really want? This is the life we really want? Here's some interesting trivia for you. Do you know who Roger Waters, a musical director and lead guitarist is? He's a guy, he's a Laurel Canyon singer-songwriter and guitarist named Jonathan Wilson. Does anybody here know who Jonathan Wilson is? You know where he's from? Spindale, North Carolina. No kidding. He put out an album this year, called Rare Birds. Sounds like Pink Floyd. It's really good. It sounds like Pink Floyd, Alan Parsons Project, Norman Greenbaum, ABBA. It's got all kinds of 70s touchstones in it. Highly recommended. Yes, check that out. He's a phenomenal guitarist, and by all accounts, he was the musical director for Roger Waters on his tour, and he's the guitarist on the album playing, Gilmore's parts. He's pretty good.
Echoes. That's my favorite thing for
you. That's my favorite thing for you. You know what?
I still mentioned it.
It's another one of those epic works. You know, this is the part where I play the ringtone of my telephone. Okay, real quick, very quick story. There's a local band called the Alarm Clock Conspiracy, led by my good friend Ian Reardon. Last year, Ian decided to put together a tribute Pink Floyd tribute, and he asked me, I play keyboards, and he asked me if I wanted to be involved. He had, how many musicians? 20, 25 musicians? We were going to do a big thing in Great Eagle. And I thought, well, this sounds interesting, tell me more. I mean, yes, and tell me more. And he said, well, we're going to do a bunch of Pink Floyd stuff, but we're only going to do Prior to the Dark Side of the Moon. And I said, well, you know, that's kind of interesting because I just got a book deal to write a book about that period. So when I got the wonderful one, here's my other favorite Pink Floyd song. I got to be in rehearsals with all these musicians who were sorting out how to play. We did the full 23-minute version of Echoes. We did a 5-minute distillation of Adam Hart Mother. We did about half of Metal, the other half of Metal. We did a bunch of Obscured by Clouds. We did all that stuff. And if I can find this, which I can, here we go. No, 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 that's okay. So anyway, one day when I was at practice, they were working on some stuff, and so I just hit the recorder. And so here's Ian and the guys. Basically, what you do is you take a wah-wah pedal, and you unplug it, take the cables, switch them around, plug them back in the wrong way, turn the pedal around, and then you work the volume knob on your guitar, and it sounds like seagulls or humpback whales. And if you've heard Echoes, there's a 3 or 4 minute interlude in the middle of the song that sounds like that. Well, we played it like that in front of, of course, being a keyboard player, I got to just sit there and drink beer during that part, because there's nothing else to do. But, so, it made a big difference to me as I was working on the book to be in a room with musicians who are deconstructing this music. You know, you can look at it from a, you know, you can look at the lyrics, you can look at the way it was made, but to actually be in a room with people figuring out how to play it, it was a gift. It was, and the timing was just serendipitous. I had no idea that was going to happen, but, so we did a thing at the Great Eagles, 4.5 hours, and it was pretty cool. Unfortunately, the bootleg of it came out terrible. I just got my recorder and it's all overdriven. Somebody over in this area had a question.
I just wanted to say that we saw Roger Waters last year.
Oh, you did? You saw that tour?
Such a great, great performance. It was just like the angst and the rage, and it was the cinematography and the lights and the color and the sound. It was just really terrific.
I wish I had seen
the best shows. Yeah. I've been to, we didn't know what to expect.
Really?
Especially, it was at this crappy Coliseum. It was amazing that they got that to work with the sound.
Really?
And so
I wish I had seen it. That was his excuse for not being interviewed for the book, was that he was on tour, which is a pretty good excuse.
Is he out of trouble with the Israelis?
You know, it's so funny. I've done 22 radio interviews about the book, and a lot of them have been for sort of angry white guy AM radio stations, not to get political, but I kept wondering when someone was going to ask me about that, and nobody did. The answer is I don't know. The answer is I don't know. He doesn't have a problem, from what I understand, he doesn't have a problem with Israel, he has a problem with the Israeli government. Well, it's like, and I think as Americans, again, not to get political, we can probably understand that. It's like, we don't have problems with Americans, we're just not real crazy about your current regime. So I think we can understand how there's a difference between the country and the people who are running the country. So, at least, that's how I look at it. But that's not a political book.
Were you going to talk about some of the photos from the slide?
I could, I mean.
Yeah.
Is that okay? I mean, I don't want to take everybody's too much time. But,
I just thought it was interesting how we were talking earlier about how I didn't know what any of them looked like. And
well, maybe you want to see a little more of them. Let's see. If this was a PC, we'd hit escape. That seemed to have done something. This is the first time I've ever touched a Mac in my entire life. So, what do you think? Oh, okay, that's enough. That's fairly simple. I've always heard there were two of you. My dad worked for IBM, so I was always a PC guy. Nope, that's the wrong thing. That's the wrong thing. Bear with me a second. I think it's a great idea. Where is our host come? He knows how this thing works. Oh, here, I think I found it. Is this it?
That's one.
That won't do it.
Are they on a drive?
Yeah, but I don't know anything about how that works.
Click that.
Click what?
Double click what you're...
Yeah, double click that drive. It's going to pop up.
Yeah, okay, there you go.
Right, yeah.
Now see, what I would do on a PC is I'd right click here.
Click on one at the top.
Okay. Oh, here we go. All right, now we go.
Okay.
All right.
View and view slideshow.
Well, yeah. Okay. Well, I'll do it manually if that's okay, because then I can just click and.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. So this Peter Jenner was the band's manager in the early days, and I interviewed him for the book, and I was halfway through the book when I heard back from him, and he agreed to be interviewed, and he also what it is. Not to go too far into the weeds, but when you do a book, at least when you do a book with my publisher, they give you a budget for your cover photo. And what they expect you to do is go to Getty Images or one of the online archives, pick a photo that you like, pay the license fee, and then that's the picture. So, of course, I go to Getty and all the other archives, and I'm looking at their pictures, and they're the same damn pictures that you've seen over and over and over and over again, and most of them are from the wall, which is not the era that I'm covering. I knew, because they circulate on the internet in low resolution, that there were pictures of the five-man Pink Floyd. Well, Peter Jenner took those photos. He owns those photos. He's never licensed them to any of the archives, you know, Getty or any of the others, Alamy. So I contacted him directly and asked if I could license the photo. He's like, sure. I'm like, that was easy. Hey, can we have an interview too? Sure. So halfway through the book, I had to say, I'm going to be rewriting those chapters because all of a sudden I've got, you know, the perspective of someone who was there. So this is the five-man band who was only together for those few weeks. Left to right, you've got Nick Mason, Sid Barrett. Down the bottom is David Gilmour, almost smiling for once, is Roger Waters, and then on the far right is Richard Wright, the keyboardist. First album the band made, The Pink Floyd. They actually were known as The Pink Floyd in those days, and that's A Saucer Full of Secrets. The second album, Saucer Full of Secrets, that was Piper the Gates of Dawn. This is A Saucer Full of Secrets. The band had already decided that they didn't much like having their picture on the cover. That's them.
Yeah.
You can't really see them too much, but they're their third album, More, which is a soundtrack from the film More, played and composed by The Pink Floyd. Mm-hmm. Next album, Uma Guma, which is a double album. One album is live, the other album, each of the four band members gets half of a side to indulge their creative impulses. For my money, the best of the four parts of that are David Gilmour's stuff. In fact,
there's the Gigi in there. That's cool.
Yeah.
Well, see, that's on the British pressing. The American pressing, it was made for copyrights. It's whited out.
Oh.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
I see a white square.
Yeah, because I bought the LP, you know, in 73 or something. And it also says, you know, special deal, two LPs for the price of two,
right?
You know, whatever. Roger Waters did a side project with Ron Geeson called The Body, which is a really weird, artsy film. And the songs have titles like Seven Dwarves in Venus Land and just weird stuff like that. But there's a song in there called Breathe, and talk about repurposing, that breathe is very similar to the breathe that would show up a couple of years later on Dark Side of the Moon. And his experience with Giessen on that album was a positive one, which is why when they found themselves a little bit at loose ends, they brought, let's bring in an extra composer to work on Adam Hart Mother, they brought in Ron Giessen. Now, how do I make this, how do I go, is it, I want to, there's no, there's like a, huh?
Click, and I think there's a bar that will show up.
Click where?
What do you mean?
Right there. I'm trying to, I want to, there's more pictures all over here. Oh, there you go. Okay. Right. Yes, he's showing that he's never been near a Mac in his life. Okay, that was a little too far. Let me go back.
No, just go to the top.
Oh, okay, yeah, all right.
That's it.
Yeah, so Risky Coin, that's the soundtrack album. Came out on MGM, and that they ended up having only a, you know, a couple songs on. But also with songs by the Grateful Dead, the Kaleidoscope, the Pink Floyd, the Youngbloods, and others. They didn't mention Patti Page on the front. Yeah, kind of a strange thing.
Isn't she from the
40s? Hmm?
Patti Page, isn't she from the 40s?
That's correct. Sid Barrett did two solo albums. There's a chapter in each on the book. And his ex-bandmates were heavily involved in those. Really, if you like the Sid Barrett albums, you really have David Gilmour to thank, because they would not have existed. They would not have been anywhere near as cohesive as they were, as they ended up being without his involvement. And Jerry Sherlin, who is the drummer in Humble Pie with Peter Frampton, is on both of those albums. And I interviewed Jerry extensively for the chapters on this. And he wrote the foreword of the book as well. Next album they did, Adam Hart Mother. Mm. It's like, and Hypnosis, the creative collective that did the band's albums. They're like, give us something really psychedelic. So I could drive down the road and saw a picture of Lulu Bell. Took a picture of that. They decided they wanted that, so I went back, paid the farmer 50 quid or whatever for the use of the photo. There you go. Then an album came out called Relics, which was sort of an odds and sods. It had some singles, some tunes that hadn't appeared on albums, and a few previously unreleased tunes. If you want to hear, other than the song on Uma Guma, several small animals gathered together in a cave and grooving on a pict. Other than that, the most left field song Pink Floyd ever did is a song called Biding My Time, which has a Richard Wright trombone solo in it. And Biding My Time is on Relics. It's a really cool tune, but it does not sound like Pink Floyd.
Did Terry Gilliam do that?
The artwork?
It just looks,
it looks like that. Nick Mason did that, actually.
Oh, really?
And when it was reissued on CD, he hired Hypnosis to create a three-dimensional objet d'art. I went to business school, so. But anyway, they created an actual three-dimensional version of this drawing that Mason had done, and so the CD reissue of Relics has a photograph instead of a drawing. But yeah, Mason was, you know,
like architects.
Yes, exactly right. Sid Barrett's second album, which hardcore Barrett fans like the first one. I prefer this one. This has got Baby Lemonade and Effervescing Elephant, and David Gilmour's presence is more felt on this one. Gilmour produced the album, and he, you know, was very careful to not let his personality get into the music. He refused to play any guitar on the album. So it's all the guitar work is Sid Barrett on that record. They performed live a couple times, and the band, it was a trio. It was Barrett on guitar, Gilmour on bass, and Jerry Shirley on drums. And there are bootlegs of that. They did a performance, and about halfway through the third song, Barrett takes his guitar off, walks off stage, and then the rhythm section goes, you know, like that kind of, ladies and gentlemen, Sid Barrett, you know, and that was his last performance. Let's see, where'd that thing went? How do you do that?
Just click there.
Click there?
Yeah.
Did he what?
Did
something. He lived, he moved back to Cambridge and lived a quiet life. He gave up pretty much, with the exception of, I didn't tell the whole story about him showing up for during the sessions for Wish You Were Here, which he did. Not once, as the story goes, but many times, I found out during my interviews. He put his guitar down by about 74, and after that, he channeled all of his creative energies into painting. He did some amazing, if you go online and look, there's a Sid Barrett website, and he was an accomplished painter, beautiful stuff. But, so all that creativity that he had channeled towards music didn't go away, didn't evaporate, he just reached out. And he didn't do interviews, he didn't, by all accounts, he never picked up a guitar again after about 74.
Just used it down there.
What down there?
Well, the one is
on. I don't see it.
On the keyboard.
On the keyboard.
Oh, on the keyboard. Oh, okay.
There you go.
Oh, okay, cool. Oh, thank you, thank you. Okay, Metal. Okay, Metal is the album that has Echoes on it.
That's
Obscured by Clouds. Not one of their better album covers. There's a person there. You can just barely see them. They included the film, which has long been hard to get. They included the film on the box set, the big $600 box set. But the characters shift seemingly randomly between English, German, and French, and there are no subtitles. So it's kind of hard to watch unless you speak all three of those languages.
I have to say, I got to see them perform that at Radio City Music Hall in 1973.
Oh, you saw the Obscured by Clouds tour?
Yes, I did.
Wow.
It was a crazy, fanatical friend of mine, Greg, and it was like so strange. There were people online that were like, trying to buy my ticket from me, they were offering me like hundreds and hundreds of dollars.
And that was more money then than it is
now. Oh yeah.
Yeah,
I
love it.
Well, like, your money means
nothing.
Wow. It was really cold. It was really incredible. The sound was perfect, because back then, concerts, the sound was not that great.
Yeah, you did the house PA. They brought their own PA. It was
definitely
Radio
City was always amazing.
Always good.
Yeah, the acoustics were good.
Perfect thing. It was like, that was like just once. They did one show, and that was it.
Wow.
They left town.
The albums prior to Dark Side of the Moon didn't really sell very, very well in the States. Metal and Obscured by Clouds would eventually go gold, but a lot of that happened. Imagine this. You paid 73, you bought Dark Side of the Moon, you took it home, you're like, oh my God, this is great. What else can I get by this band? You go back to the store, well, they're not going to have copies of Saucer Full of Secrets. They're not going to have the Moore soundtrack. Those are 5 years old from a band that wasn't selling a lot. They did have copies of Metal. They did have copies of Obscured by Clouds. So those albums charted in the wake, in the retroactive wake of Dark Side of the Moon. They switched labels after Dark Side. They went from Capitol to Columbia, from Harvest to Columbia. So Harvest wanted to cash in, understandably, and so they issued this 2-LP set called A Nice Pair, which is basically the first two albums, but they take, inexplicably, they take the studio version of Astronomy Domine off, and they add on the live version off Umaguma. But so that's, I bought that album when I was a kid. But it was a 2-LP set. It was the only way to get the first two albums in the States for a long time. That, of course, means...
But you didn't learn why they did that, writing the book.
Why
is that? I've never understood that.
I don't know. I have no idea why they did it. I think
it
doesn't make any sense to me.
Because there's nothing wrong with the...
No. I mean, it sounds more like the band that most people know,
I guess,
but that wasn't
right.
The point of that set. I don't really know. That's the Azimuth Coordinator.
Oh.
Pretty, yeah, I mean, does that, it looks like, it looks, you know, like it was thrown together. It was, I mean, yeah. And so, Richard Wright had that sitting on top of his Farfisa or his B3 or whatever, and he would, you know. No, that came a little later. That came a little bit later. I like Richard Wright. Okay, there's... If you're they didn't appear on the cover of their albums, but if you bought Metal and opened it up, the gatefold, that picture was inside. That is the Barrett era band. So there's Sid right there, Waters, and it looks like, it looks more like Wright than Mason. I can't really tell.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, this would have been around 72 or so. That's, of course, David Gilmour. This is, I do like this shot. This is the shot they have on Wikipedia, but it's pretty cool. It's, I mean, Nick's got his drums that have got the Japanese waves. I forget the name of the famous Japanese artist who did all the waves. Who's somebody here?
Is there Okasai?
Hmm?
Okasai.
I think so. We'll go with that. There you go, looking a little like maybe they, you know, the thing is, you know, people think of Pink Floyd as a really psychedelic band, and while I, you know, I can't tell you what they did on a day-to-day basis, that lineup, at least in the period 68 to 73, they liked to drink.
Right.
They, you know, they smoked some pot, they liked to drink, these guys were not doing acid. They were not doing the hard stuff at all. That just, it did not inform their music. And as much as they're kind of thought of as an acid rock band, not really.
That's like Grateful Dead, Eric and Herb.
Well,
please,
yeah. I understand your good graces, so I'm not going to talk about it anymore. Yeah, just a couple of shots from that same session. Yeah, they're smiling. Oh, that's outside the one of the botanical gardens. Yeah, that's a cool shot. That's a fairly famous promo shot. That was when I went through all the archives. That was the one that was available, and I thought, well, that's cool.
It's so pink.
Right. But I really wanted to show. So the rest of the story. So the picture that I used, which is not on the slideshow, is the five-piece band, but I photoshopped Sid to look like a ghost. And I haven't gotten in trouble for that yet. We made a license fee so I can do what I want. Normally, the publisher doesn't let authors have anything to do with the cover art, but they let me do that, as long as I agreed not to get paid for it.
I hope you get sued.
Yeah, no, we won't, okay, again, this is interesting because it's the Barrett era band, but if anyone's familiar with the band The Creation, anybody know The Creation?
Sure.
Well, and who stole what from The Creation? Jimmy Page stole the violin bow from Eddie. Well, there you go, in 1967, there's Roger Waters playing his bass with a violin bow. I thought that was interesting. Another early shot. This is again. There's Sid on the right. Okay. Another live shot of the band. Wright is off to the left. You can't see him, but he's got a Fender Compact Duo, which is pretty cool. I'm sorry, a Farfisa Compact. Yeah, he played Farfisa organs for a long time. Here's a cool shot of Sid. One of the. There aren't a whole lot of really good color shots of Sid live on stage. He'd glued these metallic discs onto his Telecaster.
What's on his shirt?
Let me go back.
Sorry.
They look like little flowers. It almost looks like some of Gerald's scarf's animations for the wall, doesn't it?
They look like mushrooms.
Yeah. That's pretty cool.
A lot of times they were shopping in the women's department for good rock and roll clothing.
Like a Robin Hitchcock shirt.
Yes, it does look like a Robin. I interviewed Robin Hitchcock for the book too. Robin Hitchcock, before anybody leaves, when we get done, I'm going to look it up. I'm going to look it up in my index. Robin Hitchcock, when I interviewed him, gave me, I think, one of the best quotes about Pink Floyd that I've ever heard. And when he said it, I was like, oh my God, that's going to the book. And so it's in the book. Here's a really early shot of the band. This is when they were a five-piece. They were called the Pink Floyd Sound, and that's Bob Close to the right of Sid there. So this was around the time that they did all those demos that are on the first disc of the big box set.
And they did films too. They were doing these little films, right? Walking around in woods, films and stuff.
Well, they did some films, some promo films around the time of *Piper at the Gates of Dawn*. That would have been about a year after this.
Animations too.
Well, there you go. A nice, your typical pop star photo there.
Boys.
I know. Yeah.
Yeah, there's like a Rocket Smith on the right.
More pictures of the city or a band.
Were any of them related, like this one?
To each other?
Mm-hmm.
Not that I'm aware of, no.
They don't look
I mean, you know, they didn't have the little DNA thing.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
One thing that's funny is that their manager told me that, says, from the earliest days, Roger Waters had absolutely no fashion sense. He said he was the worst, worst dresser. That, you know, he would try, I mean, look at that shirt. Oh, my so
yeah,
that
awesome.
Is pretty, even by 67 standards, that's pretty hideous. Yeah, and Wright started going gray very young, actually. There you go. Look at Roger. Doesn't he look like he's sitting there with the scarves? It's like, who dressed you, huh? Yeah, okay, now this is kind of a fun one, backstage. Oh yeah, there it is. So that's the Photoshop. That's what's on the cover of the book. And that's...
Like a great composition, you know,
huh?
With him in it, it's better composition.
Exactly. Well, he was, he's in the original shot.
Oh, really?
Yeah, no, he's in the shot. I just ghosted him out. Yeah, I think not only the other ones, just because it laid out better. Yeah, it laid out better for a book cover and it was easier to Photoshop.
Bill, did you use the series of YouTube videos with Ron Hitchcock about Sid Barrett at all?
No, I just spoke directly to him and asked him stuff. Gilmore, Waters? That's the back cover of the CD version. Inside sleeve of the Dark Side of the Moon LP, which of course, as anyone who bought it knows, came with two posters and two stickers. The Japanese version came with an 8x10 booklet with photos of the pyramids and two different posters and all the lyrics in Japanese with the typically wonderful bad translations. Of the era. Yeah, that's the poster that came in the, one of the posters that came in the American LP. That's the other poster that came in the American LP. That was a logo that, you know, bands didn't all have logos back in the 60s. They didn't run with this one, but they did have that for a little while. Typical, archetypical photo of everyone's friend Nick Mason.
Wow.
Who's seen Pink Floyd at Pompeii? You must see that. It was a film made in 1972. They go to the ruins of Pompeii, they set up their gear, and they play to the ghosts. It's wonderful. When it was all done, it was decided that it wasn't long enough, and so they added in footage of the band working on their then current album, The Dark Side of the Moon. So, It's interspersed, so it's a concert with no audience. In between the songs, it's them in the studio, messing around with the VCS3 and Gilmore overdubbing lead guitar parts. It's wonderful. When I was in high school, they had midnight movies every Saturday night. I think I saw Pink Floyd at Pompeii probably 30 times. Now that, and Let It Be, Rock and Roll High School, you know, it was pretty cool.
The Delicate Sound of Thunder, that was a really good one.
Oh, that's much later though.
Right,
that's
right.
Like,
oh, yeah,
kids
that's
by
like
then,
the
yeah.
80s.
No, not quite, yeah. Yeah. Here's a still from the production of Pink Floyd and Pompeii. And there's another still from it, you know, very little in the way of effects, although there's one part where there's close-ups of Gilmore's hand playing his Strat, and then I have it 16 times across the screen, and if you're in the audience, you're going, wow! It's very cool. Another, okay, yeah, that's another still from the film.
Spinal Tap.
yeah, way before Spinal Tap, yes, okay, that's just the one over there. There's Richard Wright. There's Waters. That's one of the stickers that came with Dark Side of the Moon. That's the other sticker that came with Dark Side of the Moon. I worked at a record store in the 80s, and I got a stack of those stickers like this. I used to just give them away. I only have a few left now. In the studio.
I don't want to overshare. Welcome.
Oh, okay. Well, okay, I'm going to just pass through these. So there's Sid. And oh yeah, that's the last one. That's their touring van. And the big $600 box set is a black box with a diagonal white stripe made to look like their van. Thank you very much. You've been really amazing. It's been a lot of fun.
Can we quickly hear the
Robin Hitchcock
quote?
Oh, thank you. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, my wife, thank you very much. Audrey. And Audrey did serious amounts of research for the book. The book draws on lots and lots of interviews and reviews, concert reviews, album reviews from back in the day, not now. Because now it's one thing to go, oh, Dark Side of the Moon's great. What did people think of it in June of 1973? She found all the stuff.
I have an opinion about that. I remember going to four parties in one night. Every party was playing an album, and we were saying, like, damn, why do they play, like, real Pink Floyd, stuff that, you know, there's a lot of, like, talk, like, why is everyone playing that album all the time? You know?
Right.
Get my funny friend.
Okay. With his trademark faculty for memorable phrases, Robin Hitchcock described Sid Barrett as, quote, drum roll, please. Part of Pink Floyd's acceleration, he was the rocket booster that got Pink Floyd off into the stratosphere and then just fell away.
That's perfect.
He said that and I was just dumbstruck.
That's
that nails it. You know, had it not been for him, they would have never got started, but he had to fall away for them to go on the path that they went. Had he stayed, they would have broken up in a couple of years. They would never have made anything like Dark Side. Listen, thank you again. This has been a real treat for me.